Well, all right, I'll tell you. No, all right, no, I'll tell you. A true life story, the kind that never gets written. My brother was in the Army, and like everybody else's brother, and like me and everyone else I ever knew. And he was in the Army, and he was assigned to a place out in Burma. Well, now, this immediately, you know, the New Yorker always has these wonderful little stories about simple folk who live in Burma, and simple little recollections by a Burmese girl about a Burmese childhood. Well, let me tell you what happened in Burma. My kid brother's in Burma, see, and they're living in this village. There's about 38 guys, and alternately, each guy is taking turns for going out of his skull for a week, and they'd strap him down for 1 week. I mean, I don't know whether you've ever lived in the Burmese jungles in the rainy season for 3 straight years. With dengue fever and malaria coming out of your ears and eating spam 47 times a day. Well, that's about the extent of it. And you'd follow it with Adderall pills for dessert. You know, just a big handful of them down the gullet. Well, that's the kind of existence it was. And once in a while, there would be the drone of 17,000 Jap Zeros going over who would strafe you on the way to wherever they were going to strafe other people. And then about 20 minutes later, there would be a bunch of P-51s going after them, and they would strafe you, too, simply because you had gone native and looked like a Jap down there in the woods, and you'd get that, too, from both ends. So that's the way it was. And nobody ever wrote this war up. You know, it was called the Forgotten Theater. And even today, there are guys still out there that don't know the war is over. There's a whole division. Believe me, there is an ASCA outfit out there who's been there for over 23 years. Just because their teletype wire never got through, and it never did get through. That's another. This is the way Burma was. Well, my kid brother's living in Burma, see, and he has lost like 9,000 pounds. He now weighs 8 ounces, and he's 6'4". And you could see his bones through his bones. You could just see it on the other side. You could see him all the way through. And it's just that kind of life. So they had problem with the native cows. The cows around there would come around, so this in the Far East, in certain areas particularly, there are a great religious significance connected with cows. And the cows would come on, and they lived, oh, by the way, I have to tell you how they lived. They lived in what they called bashas. A little basha was made out of straw. They lived in a native hut, really was what it was, with a little raised kind of patio, and it was put up and it was raised up on pilings about 3 feet off the ground for good reason, which we will get to later in the story. Because during the rainy season, the ground was covered with a 3.5-foot coating of snakes, all of them poisonous, and it came right up to your porch, all the snakes, not mud, just snakes. And you would walk down, the mud was 3.5 feet below the snakes. That was another thing. And then there was a layer of small marsupials that injected some kind of poison into you, if properly approached. And then there was about a 6-inch layer of large red jungle leeches, they too adding their confusion to the scene. Well, that was, you got the situation. Oh, the temperature is roughly always there, 175, with a humidity in the vicinity of the same figure. You know what is it, a saturated humidity? You know what a saturated humidity is, saturated heat? In technical chemical terms, you can get more than 100% saturation of the humidity. Are you aware of that? That under certain heat conditions, you can get more than 100%. You understand that when we hit 100%, that it rains? Well, it can get over that. That's a super saturated steam. Well, that was the climate there. It was unbelievable. And so, day after day, these guys would look out into the gray, steamy, swirling mists of the jungle. And they would hear the slow, steaming, misty, gray chanting of the natives around them, living their own native life, which had been going on for millions of years there, unchanged. And occasionally the sound, 18,000 vultures would land on a cadaver. The natives would just die, and that's all. And down would come the vultures, and the GIs would look out, and one of them would go out of his skull. They'd tie him down. It was his week to be off his rocker. And each guy, by the way, could hardly wait for his week. They would just take turns. And there were 38 of them, and every 38th week you could be off for 1 week, and you'd be strapped down there, and they're injecting you with something to make you stop screaming. And so that's how they got high, by the way. They'd inject them with this drug that made them stop doing whatever it is you do when you have an overdose of Adderall and an overdose of malaria and an overdose of dengue fever. You know what dengue fever is called? It's called bone break fever. You know what that is? I had a case of it once, a real quick case of it. It's an indescribable thing. Ever since that time, I can't feel sorry for Hovind Caulfield. I always remember what happened to me once. bone break fever is an inflammation of the marrow of your bones. Well, I have to point out you have marrow in all of your bones everywhere, and all of it gets inflamed. Well, all I can say that you feel like somebody has wired you together with red-hot ice picks. You are wired together. That's what you become very much aware of your bones. You know, you don't know you've got bones most of the time. I always used to hear about guys breaking a bone, and I figured, well, that was guys that had bones that this happened to. You know, I just never figured I would have it because I never busted one. You say, well, I got this problem of bone break fever and everything. It's just incredible. I cannot describe it to you. It's like the pain or the searing, burning sensation starts roughly 4.5 feet above your head, somewhere up in the air, and continues to about 16 or 17 inches below the surface of the soil, and extends to infinity on all sides around you, to the horizon. It's an incredible. It's like you have become a gigantic human boil, and you are about to pop. You know, and somebody is squeezing you gently from inside. You can't get at them. It's incredible. You can't sit down. You can't stand up, because if you stand up, you're standing on your feet. Figure that one out. Your feet got it. You can't lie. You lie down, and it's all over you. You see, if they hang you up by your ear, which is about the only way you can exist for a while with bone break fever, then you find out that you've got a bone in your ear. You never knew you got a bone in your ear. Well, let me tell you, that one hurts too. It hurts worse than any of the other ones because it's close to headquarters. It's connected right in. It's got a short circuit, then boy, I'll tell you, it goes off. And your backbone, you can hear your backbone at night. You can just hear your backbone muttering. It just mutters. Did you ever have the feeling that your wrist could become, could go into hysteria? That's the truth. Your wrist itself, you look at it, and it's delirious. Your wrist is dreaming of something else. It's got a thing going. Well, that's the kind of life. You see, everybody's got bone break fever, and they've got it all, you see. And the vultures keep landing. And about every 20 minutes, a cow comes in. And you know how cows are. Cows are not really housebroken. No, they're not. No. You can housebreak a French poodle, but it's very difficult with a very large cow, especially a very large sacred cow. That's a complicated problem. It gets into all kinds of Kama Sutra situations there. You get into certain subspecies of the Buddhist religion. Oh, it gets all very involved. So these guys would be all lying on their bed of pain and trying to carry on whatever nefarious thing they were carrying on there in the jungle when in would walk the cow. And the cow would take a look around. They have cleaned their place up for the first time in a month. And there was a rule that don't shove the cow. In fact, it had come down from MacArthur's headquarters, any son of a gun in this command that lays so much as a finger on one cow will be up against the nearest brick wall within 5 minutes. There will not even be a trial. Forget it, because God is involved. All right. So they didn't want to offend the natives. Well, of course, the natives didn't seem to worry about offending the GIs. That's another story entirely. Because we're never considered natives, you know that. Nobody worries about offending us. So they're lying on their bed of pain and screaming and hollering and taking the Adderall tablets and going out into the jungle to work the transmitter. That was the job, working the transmitter. And they would go out there, they'd work the transmitter, and they would come back. And the rain would come down, and the snakes would wander over the ground, and the little marsupials would squeak. And the giant rats, they have a rat over there, you know, believe me, they have a rat over there that scares camels. That rat, there is a rat over there that weighs over 2,700 pounds, fully grown. And, of course, most of them, honestly, what is good about it is that most of them in that neighborhood were the midget rats of that species. They don't go over 1,200 pounds. And so they got the rats going, everything. And about every 20 minutes, the cow would come in. Well, my brother up to this point had been a Borden fan. You know, Elsie and Elmer the cow. Somehow, Elmer the bull and Elsie the cow, excuse me, I don't want to offend any people out there. these farmers can get very excited. Well, he had been a cow fan, you know, like most city people are. You kind of like cows. Or some, the idea of a cow is a nice concept in an abstract way. Yes, it is. I mean, nobody thinks of milk in a cow. You just think of a big, warm, liquid eyes looking at you and that wonderful, soft, fawn-colored face and all that stuff. Well, the cows do other things. Cows have other habits, which are rarely discussed when Elsie is discussed. Well, this cow somehow, in fact, there were about nine of them, somehow they took a liking to the basha that these guys were living in. I guess it was because they had a little moon carved on the outside, their little window in the shape of a moon, and the cows took it literally, and it was just a wild scene, and about every 20 minutes the cows would come in through this place. And they would all sit there scared of the cow. These cows are very big cows. These cows are like 9 feet tall, and they got enormous horns. And not very friendly. You know, for a sacred cow, you kind of think of a sacred cow as being a little bit, you think in terms of religious figures. Well, these cows were not like that. They'd come in with their horns, and they'd rip up, you know, they'd just give a guy a nudge and push over a wall or walk over and look in, you know, when the guys are lying there, sleeping, knock over a bed, step on somebody, and then, you know what cows do, all over the floor. And so it just went on steadily like that. And one day, somebody decided, well, and this was an outfit that dealt in electronics, we're going to have to do something about this situation. And there was a rule that says, no GI can lay a hand on a cow. No GI can touch a cow. Well, the simple GI, always knowing what to do. As you know, GI know-how, Yankee know-how, well, it works occasionally. They took a piece of wire and strung it around outside the basha, about a foot and a half tall around the wire. And they just strung it around there, you see, and they connected one of their power transformers from the transmitter up to it. They figured it would just give the cow a little, you know, a little jolt, and everything would be okay. And that would teach the cow, and they would learn. You know, Pavlov reasoning, a couple of shocks, and the cow will not come in there, and we'll start going next door, where the officers live. Well, what happened was this. About 3 o'clock in the afternoon, when everything was at its most peaceful around there, and the natives were all up and walking around, and the vultures were flying, and the rain was coming down, and the rats were squeaking, and everything was going. Everything was under control. A large cow, very publicly, walked down the street and in the general direction of the basher. Well, all the GIs at this point were looking forward to it. So this is, okay, here it comes now, right? And they're looking out of the window. Okay, here it comes. Okay, all right. I got the switch ready over there, Chuck. Okay, all right. Hey, Harry, all right, get out of the window. When you they see that? Don't let the cow see you. It's going to suspect. So the cow keeps walking. This great religious figure has come along. And the cow is coming towards the fence. And the cow gets up to the fence. And it leans into the fence. And it starts to push onto the fence. And then, okay, get. Boom! Oh, wow! Well, for about 15 or 20 milliseconds, there is a gigantic blue flash that hung in the air. Incidentally, about 27 million natives in that area who saw it had a fantastic religious conversion. It was just, there was an upsurge of Buddhism like has never been seen. Anyway, there was an explosion there that didn't stop. And about 4 or 5 seconds later, pieces of cow started to descend for miles around, and what was worse, the cow continued to moo. Well, there they were, confronted with a genuine ideological split. They had no idea this would occur. Well, within about a minute and a half, there was a fantastic native delegation that began to appear, protesting this visitation from the blue. They did not quite understand electronics. All they knew was that the GIs were in league with an evil god who had dealt an unfair blow to one of the good gods. And they were here to see that there was some kind of retribution made, if not justice. And they were playing drums and loops and harps, and guys were playing nose flutes, and they were moving around the little paddy. And they're all sitting in there looking out. Three guys got an attack of malaria as it happened. One guy came down with bone break fever. It was all psychosomatic, of course. They could hear the vultures fluttering above them, and then it began to occur. Then it began to happen. The natives had a system in that area. Whenever approached by evil gods, of throwing darts with messages on them at a carved image of the god. So darts began to come out of the jungle at the little native basher. Oh, by the way, my brother up to that point had been a Holden Caulfield fan. He now found himself deeply immersed in another form of ideology. 6 months later, all 17 of the GIs in the Basha were before a court in Karachi trying to defend Christianity and trying to also talk about their Basha, an afternoon spent cleaning up under the daybed. It was a problem of international relations that, as far as I know, has not yet been solved. The unit had its citation removed, and my kid brother was busted to PFC.